The third lecture, and we are discussing quantum Langevin equation. And in fact, because we have heard so much about Brownian motion, diffusion, you may as well consider our discussion to be a discussion on quantum diffusion or quantum Brownian motion. Quantum Langevin equation, or you can call it quantum Brownian motion. Quantum diffusion. So if you remember yesterday, starting from a Hamiltonian and projecting out the degrees of freedom of the surrounding system, we arrived at a quantum Langevin equation, which has the following structure. Q hat is a quantum operator, and this is a double derivative, plus integral 0 to t dt prime a zeta function, a memory kernel, is equal to eta of t, a noise. The important, I'm dropping the external potential term because that's not very germane to the issue. You should remember a few things, that q, q dot, and q double dot do not commute with each other necessarily. They actually don't. Also, eta is an operator. It's not equal to zero if t is different from t prime. And furthermore, both eta of t and zeta, they depend on the variables of the surrounding system, namely these little springy balls, okay? So in particular, if you remember that zeta has a structure, it is summation over j going from 1 to n. These are, if you recall, that the picture that we have in mind is that this large ball is connected by spring to a whole lot of other balls. And so there are n number of them. So the summation indicates a summation over these other particles. And there was this coupling constant Cj squared. And you have a factor mj omega j squared cosine omega j of t. So you can see that this function zeta actually depends on the frequency of small oscillation of these jth particles, their mass, and the coupling constant that is there, which couples the linear coordinate q of the particle of interest with the linear coordinate of the system of the bath variables. So today, what we will do is a special case where you simplify these equations to ask the question, under what circumstances would this kernel collapse into a constant friction term, which is generic to the Langevin equations that we have seen in the classical domain. So this is called ohmic dissipation. So before we do that, in order that the surrounding system acts like a heat bath, acts like an infinite bath, we must replace the summation over j by an integral over the frequencies of this Bath variable. So the way it goes is that, so there are n number of terms, and you introduce what is called a spectral density. So this is the prescription. So this quantity is called a spectral density. And you must do some appropriate scaling, like each coupling constant is taken to scale like a constant C divided by square root N. You assume that each particle has the same mass, mj, therefore is equal to m. And hence, zeta of t goes over to, in this continuum limit, to c squared over m times an integral d omega. Then there is an omega squared down there, times j of omega. Okay? So now you make the following assumption. And this is called ohmic dissipation. And the reason it's called ohmic dissipation is that if you just consider Ohm's law, you know, current moving in a wire, okay, and you also think of, let's say, an LCR circuit. If you remember, you must have all done this LCR circuit. You have an inductor, L, you have a capacitor, C, and then you also put a resistor, call it R, and then you have a battery, okay? So if you go back to your high school days, then you say that the voltage across the inductor has the structure of L di dt, all right? Then the voltage across the capacitor is the charge Q divided by C. And then there's an ohmic loss across the resistor, which is what you call Ri, and this is Ohm's law, actually. And that has the external voltage, right? Now, current I is also the charge per unit time. So you have L d2q dt squared plus R dq dt plus q by c is the external voltage. So structurally, if I put in an external force term which is linear in the coordinate, then you have the same structure as the equation of a Langevin equation, okay? Especially when you take the average of this equation, the average noise is zero, and now you look at the average quantities. So little q is like capital Q, and the fact that here the friction actually is a constant friction, the resistance is in fact a frictional term, and so the fact that this, the model that I'm going to discuss, which will allow you to fold this integral and make the kernel a constant friction, is called ohmic dissipation, is because of the structure of this Ohm's law that you are all familiar with in high school days. As you know, that if you unscramble the charge, then there's a noise on the right-hand side, and that has been studied in the, early 1930s, called the Nyquist noise, Johnson noise, etc., because when the charge is moving in a wire, its position and velocities are stochastic random processes. Okay, in school, of course, we don't worry about these things, and we simply write down a constitutive equation, Ri. You see, these are at the same level of writing constitutive equations. I mean, Ohm's law is like the Fick's law that Dr. Sabhapandit indicated, that your current density is minus the diffusion coefficient times the grad of the concentration, all right? All right? So this is in fact at the same level as the Ohm's law, where you write J is equal to sigma times the electric field, and the electric field is minus the grad of a potential. So you can compare these two equations. So these are like constitutive equations that, you know, physicists could write down from intuition. But when you start unscrambling them and do statistical mechanics, you discover many interesting features, okay? So these are all macroscopic constitutive equations, and they have a lot of wisdom behind them, like the wisdom that is there in thermodynamics. So that's the reason why we consider ohmic dissipation. So in ohmic dissipation, you assume that your spectral density has the following structure. So J of omega is omega squared over a factor D, which is a dimension of a frequency. And in order to normalize it, you put a factor 3 there. And that's equal to this structure as long as omega is less than equal to D. Otherwise, it's 0. So D is like a cutoff frequency, sometimes called the Debye frequency, and that is why we use a notation capital D. So if I have a schematic of that, then J of omega has this parabolic structure, and it gets cut off at a function, at a value D, so it drops to 0. Okay, and eventually you're going to take D to infinity. Similar models you have used when you went from the Einstein theory of specific heat to the Debye theory of specific heat. That's another of Einstein's 1905 contributions, that he worked out the specific heat of a solid. Okay, so what happens there? Can I rub this portion off? Your zeta function, the damping term, under ohmic dissipation. And so zeta of t, therefore, goes into c squared over m. Then I can pull out 3 over d cubed. Then you have an integral 0 to d, omega d omega. I get I had an omega squared. No, sorry. Let me just. But there's no omega anymore because there was this omega squared there, which is going to cancel with, which is going to cancel with that. And so you simply have cosine omega t. So this integral is easily doable. It's 3c squared over m d cubed times sine dt over t, right? Okay. Now, so what you want to do now is to go to a limit where d actually goes to infinity. So this is a kind of time scale separation that we are constantly talking about in the context of Brownian motion. Remember that we both Dr. Sabhapandit and I have been talking about time scales. And there was something called the Stokes time scale, which was of the order of this friction coefficient gamma inverse. Then, I mean, this is not to scale. You have the intermolecular collision time scales. And then there are some microscopic time scales which have electromagnetic origin, and they're extremely, extremely small. For instance, the impact time in kinetic theory is taken to be 0, and as Dr. Sabhapandit was saying, that there's nothing really zero in physics, okay? It's just the shortest time scale. So you're going to take d going to infinity means that corresponding time scale is in this regime, okay? And we are interested in time scales much longer than capital D inverse. So there is a limit of this function sine dt over t as capital D goes to infinity. Do you know what that is? Yes, very good. It's like a delta. You can easily see that from here. because you see, if limit of d going to infinity, 0 to d, d omega cosine omega t, of course you can write this as minus d to plus d, d omega cosine omega t, and that's simply the real part of this quantity, and you take limit of d going to infinity, and that's it. So this quantity is actually pi times delta of t. So zeta of t, therefore, can be written as 3 c squared pi over m d cubed times delta of t. Right? And for reasons that will become apparent later on, we'll call this entire factor as 2 gamma. So let me write it as, actually you could call it 2m gamma times delta of t. So when that happens, this equation becomes simpler, and then for that, this equation reduces to q double dot. This integral now folds because of this delta function, 2m gamma q dot of t is eta of t, and you're back at the familiar Langevin equation. All right? Is finite, yes. Yes. You have to tune the coupling constant similarly. So that's the scaling here, Abbas. The coupling constant C is actually very large to be taken, so that each coupling constant, the limit of n going to infinity, is actually not such a large constant. So you know that when you have no memory, that is, you have a constant friction, yet you will see soon that the system is non-Markovian because the correlation of eta of t with the autocorrelation, eta of t prime, is not going to be a delta function in time, which is the hallmark of classical Langevin equation. For a Gaussian process or Wiener process, where this is this autocorrelation is also a delta function in time. So let's look at that now. Before that, questions? Thing is very very similar, except that you also are doing it in the sense of dynamics. If you remember that your heat capacity at constant volume. All right? Heat capacity at constant volume in a solid in classical theory is given by what? What is the specific heat at constant volume for a solid in the classical domain? As a function of temperature. As a function of temperature? T. What is it? How does the graph look like in the classical domain? Huh? Sorry? It's constant. It's somebody's law, right? Dulong and Petit. Because see, energy scales like linear in temperature. Equipartition theorem. Right? Energy scales like temperature. And so when you look at these excitations, why do you get specific heat? Because you're saying that as you heat a solid, each atom sort of vibrates around its mean position. Of course, at very high temperature, the motion will be very nonlinear and eventually it will melt the system. But if you are not at such high temperature, you say that these are like classical harmonic oscillators. And for classical harmonic oscillators, equipartition theorem applies. Average energy scales like T, And the heat capacity is the rate of derivative of the average energy with respect to temperature. So you get a constant called the Dulong Petit behavior. So I think it is something like 3 nkb, right? Where n is the number of such particles. Then, as you go down in the temperature, what happens? The d by t cube law. So you peel off at some point. So that's due to fermions, right? And further down, what happens? No. Einstein oscillator problem is a single oscillator, and you do the partition function and calculate specific heat for a single oscillator. That did not agree with experiments, and Debye pointed out that you actually have to average over or integrate over a spectral function of or density of states of those fermions. So both Einstein and Debye were operating with harmonic oscillators, quantized harmonic oscillators, which behave like fermions. But I'm saying now if you go to ultra-low temperature, what happens? You have to worry about then the electronic contribution to the specific heat. Right, from the Fermi-Dirac statistics. And the Fermi-Dirac statistics, the specific heat is linear. We know why it is linear? Yeah, right, phase-space argument, because, see, the Fermi distribution function is something like this at t equal to zero. But, you know, as you change the temperature a little bit, then you say these guys, these electrons are the excitations of the Fermi surface. They are the ones which contribute. And they are of the order of kBT over the Fermi energy EF. And each of these electrons also actually has this classical kind contribution. So you get T squared energy. When you take the derivative, you get linear specific. That's a heuristic argument. So you have a linear specific heat. And then eventually, you merge into this Debye behavior. So here also, you can massage this spectral function to talk about electronic heat bath and as well as phononic heat bath. Because if you have a metal, then at low temperature, the bath properties would be governed by Fermi statistics. Then Bose statistics will take over. It's again the density of states considerations. Sorry, I mean, should be continuity here. My sketch is not quite right. And then eventually go into the classical domain. Okay? Right? Remind you from our previous lecture, noise eta of t is summation again j equal to 1 to n, a coupling constant cj, then you have qj of naught minus cj Q of naught over mj omega j. And these are capped on so that they represent quantum operators. And then you have the momentum at time t equal to 0 over mj omega j sine omega j t. Let me just check my factors. Okay. As this is squared. And there's an extra CJ here. Okay. So let me again remind you that what we call noise is noise in the thermodynamic sense. I mean, it depends on dynamical variables, like the coordinates of the jth particle of the surrounding system, the momentum of the jth particle surrounding system, and their initial values, and the initial value of the position operator for the system of interest. So they undergo fluctuations in the sense of thermodynamics. They're not external noise. So today you can generate noise in a box or in a computer, and drive a system, and you can fiddle with the machine and do a computer experiment as well. But we're not doing that. We're actually talking about a real physical many-body system, which is in Brownian motion. Okay? So it is therefore obvious that if I take the average of eta of t, the average of these linear terms would be equal to zero. The next question that you ask is, what is the correlation property of eta of t? And before that, just to underscore the fact that eta of t is a quantum operator, let me compute the commutator of eta of t with itself at a different time. So first ask the question, what is a commutator? Now, this is a departure now already from classical theory, because there's nothing called a commutator in classical theory. So you will see what is going to happen here. So let's consider this quantity. And in particular, we're going to take the expectation value of this operator. And you can ask me the question, what do you mean by the expectation value? So what do I mean is very firmly stated, which is that when we say that the surrounding system is really like an infinitely large system, and when we want to consider it as like a heat bath, then that means that the surrounding system is in thermal equilibrium at a temperature T. Therefore, its thermodynamics is governed by Gibbs statistical mechanics, okay? Equilibrium statistical mechanics. So this expectation value is actually over the partition function for the full Hamiltonian that I wrote down. Okay? And in particular, the piece of it which deals with the harmonic oscillator-like system, which is what constitutes a surrounding heat bath. So this average is something that you're all familiar with. This is what you do in equilibrium statistical mechanics. So now you look at these two, these products. As we said yesterday, you have a sum over j, and in eta of t prime, you're going to get a sum over j prime. But j and j prime particle are independent particles. By the way, here, we're only now concerned about non-commutativity of q and p, and that's how quantum mechanics is creeping in. We're not yet talking about statistics. So now, if I have j and j prime particles, then, of course, their averages will factor into J particle average and J prime particle average, and they will go to zero for the same reason as here. So therefore, I must only have one summation, which is over J. That's the number one observation. And the second observation that you make is that when you look at commutator, the coordinate, of course, commutes with itself. The momentum commutes with itself, but it's just the coordinate and the momentum do not commute with each other. And therefore, you'll have this cross terms. And let me just write it down. So you'll get cj squared over mj omega j. And then you have qj commutator with pj times cosine omega j t sine omega j t prime. And then you have the other term. So I'll have then minus, just one second. So you took that term, and then right, and then that times that. So you have plus. Pj Qj sine omega jt cosine omega jt prime. With P is IH bar, right? And P with Q is minus IH bar. So the net result is you have summation j equal to 1 to n Cj squared over mj omega j. Then you have ih bar. Then you have sine omega j t cosine omega j t prime minus cosine omega j t sine omega j t prime. And that is simply sine omega j t minus t prime. Okay? No? All right. So you can immediately see that in the classical domain, the Planck constant goes to zero, so the right-hand side is zero, and which is what you expect because there's nothing called a commutator when you have a classical noise. Okay. Can you, would you now allow me to do the commutator, the correlation? Let me now do that. So next thing you look at is eta of t prime correlation function. Okay. Now when you look at these structures, okay, and when you look at the product, so the kind of terms that you would have contributed to this quantity would be the square of this term, right? Because cross correlations do not exist. QP average would be equal to zero, right? So you'll have square of this and square of that, right? All right. So that would be, therefore, again, just one summation over J. Then I have Cj squared mj omega j whole thing squared expectation value cosine omega j t cosine omega j t prime plus cj squared, I have already taken into account, pj squared expectation value over mj squared omega j squared sine omega j t sine omega j t prime. Agreed? Agreed? Square karna padega na? Eta of t prime. Haan, cj square already. So there's another cj square here, right? Is that correct? No, actually there's only one CJ. So in fact, I made a mistake here. Avas, that bracket has to be, that bracket has to start from here. Because, you know, dimensionally everything has to be correct. See, P over M omega has the same dimension as coordinate cube. Okay. Question? Coordinates and momentum into, see, remember for a harmonic oscillator, your Q operator a square root h over 2m omega a plus a dagger and the P operator is I square root H bar, H omega, HM omega, A minus A dagger. Have all of you seen this ever? Okay. You have all seen this? That is how, when you write down the Hamiltonian of a harmonic oscillator, which has a structure of P squared over 2m plus half m omega squared q squared, in terms of A dagger operators, you get this structure H bar omega A dagger A plus the ground state energy, which you sometimes write as the number operator n plus half. You seen that? I think this lunch that these guys are feeding us is so good. But, you know, today you gave also fish to the bong crowd. See, either you have people from Calcutta or from Trivandrum, and both were lapping up the fish today, I think. Have you seen this before? Okay. So how do you do this P square average calculation? I'm dropping this index J. So when you do P squared, you simply take the square here. So you get a minus sign because you're taking I squared, H bar M omega over 2. And then you're going to get, okay, A minus A dagger times A minus A dagger, and then average. So you're going to get terms like A squared average, A dagger squared average. What happens to those? Huh? Why it is zero? Okay, that's very good, yeah. See, what is the meaning of average now? So A squared average, for instance, is stress A squared times e to the power minus beta times h, right? Divided by the partition function, which is stress e to the power minus beta h. Now this h has a structure here. It's a number operator. So you have beta times beta h bar omega, number operator plus half. So you can choose to work. You see, when you do the trace calculation, you can choose your quantization system. So you choose to work in the representation in which n is diagonal. And so the trace can be replaced by summation over all the eigenvalues of n, the number, right? In the Fock space, right? And A square is completely off diagonal. So when you take the trace, which is sum over diagonal elements, this term would be diagonal, and therefore this term is completely off diagonal, and therefore when you trace, there's no contribution. That's why it is zero, right? So A squared, A dagger squared, they'll all go to zero for same reasons. And therefore, I'm sorry, I forgot a minus sign. You guys are not warning me. There's a minus sign because of I squared. And so the minus sign you kill because you get H bar omega over T. And now you have A dagger A plus A dagger, right? All right? And how do you further simplify? You also have a relationship says that the commutator of A dagger A with is 1, so that A dagger A is equal to A dagger A minus A dagger is equal to 1. So A dagger is A dagger A minus 1. So you combine, so you get H bar M omega over 2 times 2 A dagger A minus 1. Or is H bar M omega A dagger A minus a half. All right? So you end up doing very simple calculation, because this is the you're back at the number operator average. And the number operator average is simply n equal to 0 to infinity n exponential minus beta h bar omega n plus half divided by the partition function right. You have all seen this before at some point in time or the other. So, and this is the easiest way to do this. First, you get rid of this constant term because they cancel from numerator and denominator. And you know how to do this because this summation is a geometric series, right? So that's like the partition function for bosonic systems. Like it'll give you 1 over, so you'll get 1 plus e to the power minus beta h bar omega plus et cetera, et cetera. You sum them up and you get 1 over 1 minus e to the power minus beta h bar omega. And you take a derivative to calculate this. And let me just write down the answer here and then I ask you if you have seen this before. The answer here is going to be h bar m omega cotangent hyperbolic half h bar omega beta. Does it look familiar to you? So when you have done the statistical mechanics of a single harmonic oscillator, actually this is what you have to do for the Einstein oscillator and calculate specific heat. Somebody said that specific heat goes down exponentially rapidly to zero for an Einstein oscillator. You have to use this cotangent hyperbolic functions. So if you still have some question about this, we can dwell with that in the tutorial. And now you see here there was another mj squared omega j squared down there. So when you combine, you're going to get a term which will be like h bar m omega cotangent hyperbolic half beta h bar omega. What about this? This is the square of the coordinate, right? The square of the coordinate is like, you know, this is going to be like the average, I mean half of the average energy actually. So you can do the same procedure, that is you write Q squared like this. Okay, and you can see that you're going to get similar factors because when you square them, you get a dagger plus a dagger a, except the prefactors are different. And these prefactors will conspire. In fact, when you take q squared, you get h bar over 2m omega, and it is the same factor, h bar over m omega, that will appear there. That factor of 2 will be killed by the fact that you get going to get these terms twice, and it's going to be the same result as you would expect. The average kinetic energy and average potential energy has the same structure, and you're going to get the same cotangent hyperbolic. So when I combine everything, but this is an exercise that we can do later on. And so when I combine everything, you're going to get summation over j, cj squared, h bar, over mj omega j, okay? And now, earlier I was getting a negative sign because you had a qp commutator and a pq commutator. That there we picked up a negative sign, and that's how you get sine omega j t minus t prime. Here I have everything positive, but except that now I have a cosine function, cosine omega j t, cosine omega j t prime, plus sine omega j t sine omega j t prime, and that is actually nothing but cosine omega j t minus t prime times cotangent hyperbolic half beta h bar omega j. So that's it. Okay. So basically, all I'm claiming is that p squared by 2m and half m omega squared q squared average, they are the same. And both give you cotangent hyperbolic, half h bar beta omega, except with some factors of 1 over m omega. Okay? And the way to show it is exactly the way we did this p squared average calculation. You do the q squared average calculation. Okay? And you would write down an equation for rho of t, which, as you know, has this structure. Okay? So this rho of t is the full rho of t for the system of interest and also the bath. So your generic way of handling these things is to say that your Hamiltonian has three parts, a part which is to deal with the system of interest, then you have a bath, and then you have an interaction term. All right? So if you want to read out from the Swansig Ford model what these things are, then HS is simply p squared over 2m plus u of q. HB is going to be the little balls. It's pj squared over 2mj plus half m omega j squared qj squared. And there's a denormalized term which goes like q squared, which can be lumped into the system when you complete the square of that term. And then this is the linear coupling term. All right? Now, in the density operator description, all right, formally you write down the solution rho of t as you know, is e to the iht over h bar, rho of naught, e to the plus iht over h bar. Right? So you have to ask the question, what is the density operator at time t equal to 0? So what we have done here, which is answers your question, is that you assume that at time t equal to 0, your system of interest is decoupled from your bath. So the density operator is a factorized density operator for the system of interest with the bath density operator. System is decoupled from the bath at time t equal to 0. And then you let it go because you let the interaction then play its tricks. Then the system evolves. And here, you assume further that rho b is given by your Gibbs measure of e to the power minus beta hb times the partition function for the bath system. So you have therefore tacitly assumed that at time t equal to 0, the bath is in equilibrium, and you have dumped the system into it. So this is in the same spirit as the jar of glycerin, which was in equilibrium in the case of Brown, and you decided to drop a ball. Okay? So that's your like time t equal to 0 experiment. And then you let the system evolve, because now the ball is interacting with all these glycerol molecules, which is through this HI. And you ask the question, how does the time evolution look like? So this is exactly what we are doing. Huh? So we're saying that at time, I'm doing here a different kind of a calculation, where I'm assuming that the bath degrees of, these are bath degrees of freedom. QGs are bath particles. They're always in equilibrium. So rho of 0, so rho b at time t equal to 0, is this governed by this Gibbs measure? P squared. So this is just, you know, your harmonic form that you have, basically a shifted harmonic oscillator. Energy is not going to change because of that. So that's the spirit of us. Okay? The reason is that you have already done the averaging. On the average, they are symmetric, but not the bare eta of t prime. And when you do the full calculation, you would have seen that there's actually, it's not symmetric under the interchange of t and t prime. Okay? Only after you do the averaging. So the average correlation functions are indeed symmetric, and so therefore this is the same as eta of t. However, they look very different from the classical result. So let's ask the question, what will happen in the classical limit? But before that, let's actually rework both this commutator as well as the correlation function using our ohmic dissipation model. Something I needed, I erased it, but it doesn't matter. So in the ohmic model, so now I'm doing ohmic here. You get this result as I h bar. The summation is going to be replaced by an integral. So d omega c squared over m omega j of omega sine omega t minus t prime. And I substitute for j of omega the ohmic form. This j of omega, as you know, is taken as omega 3 omega squared over d cubed up to d with a theta function of omega minus d. So when I put that in, so I have therefore I h bar c squared over m d cubed is a factor of 3 integral 0 to infinity. I've already gone to the d, capital D going to infinity limit, omega sine omega t minus t prime. And it is this quantity that we were calling gamma before, or 2m gamma. So I'll write it as 2m gamma times this. So this is your commutator, but more interesting is to look at the correlation function. So what about the correlation function? The correlation function is here, and that's in the ohmic limit. Is equal to, there's an h bar there, signifying that you're dealing with quantum mechanics. Then you have c squared, 3c squared, md cubed, integral, d omega, omega, because I had an omega square upstairs and there's omega down there, then cotangent hyperbolic, half beta h bar omega cosine omega t minus t prime. And it is this quantity that we would like to call 2m gamma, 2m gamma over pi or something like that. That is my definition of gamma. If you flip back your notes, that's what you will find. So you see, this is how what the correlation functions looks like. It's far from a delta function. Remember, in classical Brownian motion, the cases that Dr. Sabhapandit has discussed, I have discussed, eta of t prime correlation function is a delta function in time. But here you have a complicated integral of a cotangent function multiplying that cosine function. All right? So this is the quantum result for the correlation function. This is the quantum result for the commutator. And now you ask the question, how do I recover? Yeah. Why? Because see, there are these cotangent hyperbolic which will save you. As omega goes to, maybe it goes to 1. Yeah, so what you have to do is you have to put the cutoff d and do the integral correctly and then take the limit properly. Somebody asked the question that what is the cutoff d like? So I digressed into saying fermion, bath, bosonic bath. So d can be in a metal, d can be of the order of either the Fermi energy or the Debye frequency. Remember that there's a Debye cutoff for phonons, the Debye frequency or the Fermi energy, depending on the problem that you look at. I mean, Fermi energy for normal metals, I mean, if you divide by KB, the temperature-wise, it's like 500, 600 degrees for many metals. And that's why even at room temperature, metals have to be treated quantum mechanically. Okay. So let's pause now. And as we said, that we must be able to recover the classical results in suitable limits. So what limit should you consider now? Suppose you want to be close to the familiar results of both Dr. Sabhapandit and mine, what would you do here? Yeah, see, you say that H cross goes to 0 and beta also goes to 0 because beta is 1 over kT. So classical mechanics prevails at high temperature, so beta H bar is a product is a very small number, right? Okay, so classical limit is cotangent hyperbolic function cotangent x goes to what when you x is very small? Cotangent x. Do you remember what is cotangent x? Is cosh x divided by sinh x, right? So what happens when x is very small, please? Huh? 1 by x, very good. So cotangent hyperbolic function will go like 1 over x. So then I have 2 m gamma over pi integral 0 to infinity d omega, h bar omega, there's an h bar lurking outside, and then you have 2 over beta h bar omega cosine omega t minus t prime, and lo and behold, h bar omega cancels out, and you have 2 m gamma and 1 over beta is kBt divided by pi times 0 to infinity d omega cosine omega t minus t prime. The blue doesn't write very well, or it's not very visible, but I think it's okay as far as this result is concerned. And so what is this? What is this integral? So one-sided delta function in time, right? It's a cosine transform result of a delta function. So pi times delta of t minus t prime, and so you recover the classical result. So in the end, and your commutator would go to 0 because there's a Planck constant sitting there. So that would go to 0 in the classical case. So in the classical case, you recover all these usual results because if you remember, this was your current, this is 2m gamma, okay? And that's your Einstein relation or fluctuation dissipation theorem, that the noise correlation is the fluctuation of the noise, depends on dissipation governed by the dissipative parameter, the friction, where this temperature depends, the Einstein relation, okay? So that you recover, but in the quantum case, life is more complicated. All right? Question? Initial energy, and so we had a derivative, that's the Newtonian term. Then you had a gamma p term, and then you had put in a noise. And what, again, Dr. Sabhapandit did this today, is the question of overdamped case. So in the overdamped case, gamma, you are interested in the regime where gamma t is much larger than 1. And in that regime, you say that p dot is nearly equal to 0. Has gone down, so you flip gamma p to this side, and then you plug it back into your x equation because x dot is p over m. So you discover another Langevin equation with x in the overdamped limit. Let me forget about that. And so p is simply noise over gamma, so therefore you have a theta of t over m gamma. This is the equation that Dr. Sabhapandit was writing down. So this will be the overdamped limit of your Brownian particle, and that's the limit, that's the regime that Einstein was interested in, and it is in that regime that instead of looking at the equation of motion of dynamical variables, which is what you do in the Heisenberg picture of quantum mechanics, you have the equivalent picture of the Schrodinger, where you look at the probability equation, and that probability equation is the diffusion equation. So from there, in the last yesterday's lecture, we said, well, is it possible to give some meaning to all these things, especially since some questions arose about the meaning of the averaging over the noise? Is it time average, ensemble average? We're maintaining it's an ensemble average. And in what sense is an ensemble average? So to show that, we talked about the Swanson model, where you take a particle of interest, and you linearly couple them to a bunch of harmonic oscillators. And you write down the Hamiltonian or Lagrangian. Actually, Swanson uses the Lagrangian. We use the Hamiltonian. P squared by 2m plus u of q, if you like, and the coupling term. That's a systematic, time-independent Hamiltonian, which at this lecture we said, well, is it possible to give some meaning to all these things, especially since some questions arose about the meaning of the averaging over the noise? Is it time average, ensemble average? We're maintaining it's an ensemble average. And in what sense is an ensemble average? So to show that, we talked about the Swanson model, where you take a particle of interest, and you linearly couple them to a bunch of harmonic oscillators. And you write down the Hamiltonian or Lagrangian. Actually, Swanson uses the Lagrangian. We use the Hamiltonian. P squared by 2m plus u of q, if you like, and the coupling term. So that's a systematic, time-independent Hamiltonian, which has full reversibility, all the other properties that you want that Hamiltonian to have, namely time reversal, invariance, everything. And you start writing down the equations of motion systematically. You do that in the classical case by using the Hamiltonian dynamics. In the corresponding quantum mechanical case, you do the Heisenberg commutator equations. And eventually, you arrive actually at the same equation, which is given here, except that the properties of these terms, like eta of t and zeta, they are different in the classical case from the quantum case. And we worked out what will happen in the quantum case, especially in the simpler situation of the ohmic dissipation model. And by going to the suitable limit of high temperature and Planck constant going to 0, you recover all that you did in the classical case. So there's a consistent picture, I think, that must have emerged out of these three lectures, and including complemented by Dr. Sabhapandit's talk. And so the whole thing, you can say, is a description of what we were calling physical diffusion, okay? Like diffusion of sugar particles in a liquid, or pollen particles, et cetera, or aerosols, or colloidal suspensions, okay, or nanoparticles, whatever you have, or granular matter. A whole lot of problems come under this, and you would need quantum descriptions when you also go into the microscopic domain, where your particle of interest is a microscopic particle, like an electron, or a proton, or a muon. And the excitations and the heat bath comprises of elementary excitations like phonons, magnons, etc. So that's the whole idea. And your aim also is to see the competition between coherence and decoherence. I mean, this term describes coherence because they deal with definite phase relationships of quantum wave functions. And these dissipative terms will lead to decoherence. And it is a competition between coherence and decoherence, which is a hallmark of many interesting issues today in the physics. And so, therefore, it's important to have an idea of what happens in a dissipative quantum system. Okay? I think I'll stop here, ask if you have any question, and then in the tutorial we can go through some of the questions in more detail in terms of algebra. So are there questions here? Yeah. Particular quantum feature. So for that you have to do some actual calculation. Okay. No, sorry. I mean, you have now jumped into something else. I thought you were asking, can you calculate a physical quantity and show that the classical and the quantum results are different? That's not what you are asking, is it? So you're asking, where did the quantum mechanics come into? They came purely from the non-commutativity of position and momentum operators. And you are right, that is what is responsible for the uncertainty relationship. That you cannot measure these things accurately. Okay, non-commutativity and incompatibility of measurement. So you can't pinpoint. If you pinpoint a particle to be localized, then its momentum becomes very uncertain. So that is hidden in this non-commutativity of these operators, which we have used in abundance. You have a question? So it is coming from your microscopic interaction parameters. So they'll be related to phonon properties, etc. Right? So it's not. It's dissipation in the sense that the system, the electron motion or proton motion, is getting damped because of interactions with other degrees of freedom. By the way. If you read solid-state physics book like Kittel or Ashcroft, Mermin, they also talk about phonon drag. Phonon drag is a very common phrase in solid-state physics. Magnon drag. Okay. It's just that you don't normally worry about them. You don't worry about what is the resistance due to. But if you start asking the question that, you know, how does the resistance depend on microscopic parameters? Resistance of a wire.
But it's incredible that those people more than 150 years ago could write those things down. Isn't it incredible? And we're simply trying to unscramble them and understand the microscopic basis of that. That, I think, is mind-boggling. I mean, when did Ohm write down the equation? Jonathan? Fick is turn of the century, I mean, before 18-something, 1885, Fick. I mean, Sanjib used the Fick's law, right? Where you write current as minus D times grad C. That's the Fick's law. And Ohm is before that. Ohm is before Maxwell. Maxwell is 1860, 17-something. Imagine, right?
All the details then we can.